So good morning and welcome on this third Sunday of Advent to our service from All Saints Church in Sidmouth. My name's David Caporn and I'm the vicar here, and it's really great to be welcoming you, whether you're watching this with us live at 9:30, in which case do feel free to drop a note about yourself in the comments field, or maybe whether you're watching this catching up on YouTube subsequently. Today we are thinking about the coming of the King of Kings, and we're going to be looking at an amazing passage from Isaiah 61 that looks forward to the coming of Jesus. But we're therefore going to begin with some sung worship as Peter and Jill lead us in Make Way, Make Way. We've just sung of making way for the coming of the King of Kings. But yet we're aware that in so many ways in our daily lives, we fail to live up to the call to follow God, to respond to his call to live a holy life. And so can I therefore invite you to join with me in these words. Our Heavenly Father, thank you that you love us and care for us all the time. We know that this week we have not always lived the way you tell us. We have done wrong things and not done all the good things we should have done. Only you can save us. So please forgive us and help us to live as your friends. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And in those words of confession, we have that assurance that God forgives us. We now continue in an attitude of prayer as John leads us.
Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for your promises, which underline your love for each and every one of us, and for your faithfulness, which means that your promise endures from generation to generation. Lord, we have just stood before you and recognised that we have sinned and been disobedient to your will. We thank you that you have forgiven us and made us a new creation through the finished work on the cross of the Lord Jesus. We rejoice in our salvation and the realisation of your Holy Spirit at work in and through us, and praise you for sending your Son, the Lord Jesus, to be our Saviour. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom also he made the universe. Father, we're amazed at your work, amazed at the intricacy and wholeness and extent of your salvation that was in your plan before the beginning of time and extends beyond time itself and into eternity. How blessed we are to be caught up in your love and to experience your grace day by day. Thank you, Father, for the seeds of hope that we have experienced this past week as the vaccine program has been launched. Thank you for the amazing work that has been done to create the vaccine and to make it and now distribute it. We pray that you will give us all a sense of peace and patience to wait carefully and safely for the plan to be rolled out. We pray too that our government will work tirelessly to ensure this and other vaccines are available to all people of every nation. May the initial promises be translated into actions by every government. We pray particularly for those that are seriously ill in hospital, that they may recover, for those who are fearful and in anguish, that they may have peace of mind and spirit. We pray for those who are lonely. Help us to befriend those that we know of. Bring help and comfort to those in distress. Help us to bind up the brokenhearted and to set people free. Father, the outcome of the virus has also brought about loss of jobs and livelihoods. Many people are unable to provide for themselves and their families, and many are lacking in food and shelter across the world, and even in rich countries like our own. You taught us to pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Those are powerful words, Lord, and we ask that as we pray them, you will bring about this promise. Since the Paris Agreement in 2015, the UK government has supported a whopping £3.5 billion worth of fossil fuel projects overseas, huge gas and oil projects, making the climate crisis worse. Tier Fund has been pushing for change as part of the Climate Coalition and thought the government was about to commit to this, but it seems to have stalled at the Prime Minister's office. We're the first country to start the mass vaccination against COVID-19. We could be the first country to stop spending public money on fossil fuels abroad, which would be brilliant news for the climate and for people's health, plus investing in renewables instead could create millions of jobs globally. Heavenly Father, we pray that our government will respond to this opportunity and change the spending priorities to bring about the best possible outcomes for all people. Amen. And now let us say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Dark until you spoke, then all was light and all was peace. Yet still, O God, so many wait to see the flame of love released. Lights to the world, O light divine, kindle in us a mighty thank you.
Today's reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 61, and it is entitled The Year of the Lord's Favour. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness for prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour, and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord, for the display of his splendour. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
And so let us pray. Father, as we come and in this Advent season, as we look at your word, we ask that you would speak powerfully through your Holy Spirit to our hearts and minds. Amen. I've never been part of a discussion where people have set out their manifesto, but I suspect for politicians there's an interesting play going on of what can they promise realistically and what can they deliver. I don't know, part of me wonder sometimes if they worry too much about the delivery and ignore that and promise everything. A few years ago, I seem to remember that the official monster raving loony party had as its policy extending the Channel Tunnel to Switzerland in order to get all the gold. Whether the gold is even there, certainly it's not ethical or moral. I suspect it probably wasn't the best manifesto. But today, as we come to Isaiah chapter 61, we have an amazing manifesto before us, for the simple reason that this is the manifesto that the Lord Jesus himself uses as he begins his public ministry, as Luke records in Luke chapter 4. Jesus stands up in the synagogue, takes Isaiah 61 and reads it, and turns to the people and says, "This is fulfilled in your hearing." They understand it as being a pretty dramatic thing, to the extent that they actually look to kill him, but he slips away at that point. So therefore, today in this Advent season, as we read Isaiah 61, we need to do an exercise of reading it back in its original context and understanding what it means, but also reading it forward. Understanding what does this mean for us in the context of how Jesus uses this for inaugurating his kingdom ministry. It's a really special passage for me. Indeed, we had it when I was first licensed here 3.5 years ago. And there's a notion here of freedom. Freedom for various peoples and various parties. A few years ago, I was talking to some friends who had been to America, and they'd been staying with friends there, and they'd had a discussion on a Sunday morning about where it was that they should go to church that morning. They decided they wanted to go somewhere where they were going to get the best preacher. So they waltzed up at this particular church, and the preacher who they remembered was former President Jimmy Carter. They couldn't remember exactly what it was he said, but he said, "I think he was quite keen on freedom." Well, I don't know if it was Isaiah 61 that Jimmy Carter was speaking on, but there's certainly freedom that is a very dominant theme here. And there seems to be freedom for four parties that are declared. The Lord has appointed me to proclaim good news for the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and the release from darkness for the prisoners. four groups of people who would have very much been the underdogs, who would have been relying on the mercy of those who are powerful. Just think about that for a moment. Who might we know who are the victims of the powerful? What is it they look for? What is it they desire? And just to be clear, it's really interesting who does it. Isaiah 61 verse 1. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord, Yahweh, has anointed me to proclaim good news for the poor. Now, in the day in which Isaiah writes, that's significant, because the only people who were anointed were kings. There is a kingly identity to this particular messenger. And some of the freedom that he speaks of is for those who are downbeat, those who rely on the mercy of others, but also for those who are captives, probably meaning those who have been captured in war. And of course, the background to which Isaiah writes in many ways is one of exile, where God's people, rather than fulfilling what they're able to do, find themselves imprisoned, foreign land, at the whim of others. There are those who are jailed, who are prisoners, who are going to be released. And therefore, Isaiah speaks of proclaiming a year of the Lord's favour, of jubilee. An amazing image there is from the Old Testament of things being put back right, of balance restored, of property being given back from those who have accumulated much to those maybe who have little. It's an amazing image, isn't it? And today we're aware, aren't we, of how things need to be put right in our world. It was quite moving. You may have seen it, I think, just over a week ago, a BBC News report from Bradford, where we have some friends. And there were a couple of clergy on that moved to tears when they were speaking about some of the desperate social issues with which they were dealing. I'm sure the reality is all of us will have seen images on the TV. Many of us may know of situations that seem just hopeless, where we're aware of poverty and lack of opportunity, but where we're also aware of where there is sin. And I use that deliberately, where things have been done wrong that have ruined lives. I sadly rarely go through many weeks without talking to families that have been bereaved in the course of talking about history from the past, being aware of deep hurts and pain that there is. That sin reality is all around us, isn't it? But isn't it a great joy to find that image of the Lord's favour, of things being put right, of one coming? And therefore, as we hear Jesus talking about this, we think that's amazing, that that's what God is going to do, what Jesus does. He ushers in a new age. He meets our deepest needs. But of course, there's also a little bit of a sting in the tail, isn't there? There's some things that make us feel a bit, maybe, uncomfortable. Look at verse 2. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favour, a year, and then the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion. We quite like the idea of God who pours out blessings, but we don't necessarily often like the idea of a God who judges. But the reality is, we can't have a God who cares about the homeless, the dispossessed, the abused, who is absolutely impartial and is not bothered about the causes of that abuse or homelessness or injustice. We can't have a God who wants to put things right if he's not prepared to call to account for those things that have been done wrong. And it's worth noting the emphasis here, isn't it? The author speaks of a year of the Lord's favour, but yet a day of vengeance. God's favour brings an inevitability about, that things also need to be judged and dealt with. The two are inextricably linked. There's some ways in which this isn't necessarily unlike some of the discussions I have with wedding couples. Everyone likes the talk of love, of romantic days, of getting married, of days of celebration, of people putting on new clothes. But of course, the reality I always end up talking to them is that love is often costly. Because often each of us knows deep down, whatever our personal circumstances, that we need to be loved by our friends and family most when we deserve it least. And of course, the ultimate example of love is in Jesus Christ, isn't it? Of Jesus Christ, who actually says that this is fulfilled in him. To have the glories of the kingdom, there has to be a reckoning with what's wrong. And I suspect, possibly as we hear that, that pours a degree of fear and concern in our hearts and minds. But yet this is the good news that we point to in this Advent season. Because we remember that when the Lord Jesus comes, he also comes ultimately to die for us on the cross. He stands in our place. He enables us to be made right with God. He deals with the consequences of sin once and for all. He takes the punishment in our place. This is truly good news, because it reminds us of how God, who comes, who gives us everything when we deserve nothing. In this Advent season, we look forward to celebrating the coming of Jesus, but also in terms of looking forward to his return. A return that we can be hopeful about, because we know that the penalty has been paid for us. That Jesus lives the life that we can't and stands in our place. That's why, as we read this passage of Isaiah 61, we should be led in a sense of awe and wonder. Here is a God who doesn't leave us in the mess that we are in, but comes to rescue us. Through his action, leads us to a glorious future. When those images of verse 3 and 4 of restoration and rebuilding will come true. Today, maybe you have that invitation to reflect on your life, to reflect on your circumstances. Once again, maybe to marvel on the grace of God, who gives us everything when we deserve nothing. It might be even for the first time to respond to that, to reflect on these words of Isaiah 61, and to reflect on the Jesus who stands in the synagogue and says, today these words are fulfilled in your hearing, who gives us that invitation and says, come, follow me. What will be our response? What will be our prayer? Are we ready to listen? So we reflect on that. We might want to come on our knees once again before God and bring before him those things in our world that we know aren't right, to ask him to restore them, to ask him to forgive us for when we get things wrong. Then in a moment, we're going to finish with that reminder of grace as we sing our next song, which reminds us of how glorious it is that Christ has come as the Messiah, the one who has come to save us. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your grace and that you don't leave us where we are. And whether we feel burdened and weighed down today or whether we feel light, we thank you that you came and died for us, that you fulfilled this picture that Isaiah has, that that was your manifesto. We thank you that you forgive us and die for us. Help us to never take that for granted, but to be in awe of your mercy poured out so freely on us. Amen.
Hi, Kaz. How are you?
Yes, good, thank you.
Great to have you with us. Now, as you know, we're advertising for a new alpha. We're starting a new alpha in January, which is all really exciting. And you have been on the one that is just coming to an end now. So I thought it would just be wonderful to ask your experience of how you found alpha and whether you'd recommend it for anybody else or why you'd recommend it. Cass, just tell me, what have you enjoyed about the Alpha course? What have you enjoyed being on it these last few years?
I haven't attended church regularly, and I wasn't brought up religious at all. And there's been always something that I just thought, you know, there's got to be something more to life. There's got to be some sort of purpose, and especially sort of after this crazy year, I saw it on the end of a newsletter that you were running one. And something just kind of went, oh, that'd be, you know, maybe that'd be good, maybe. So I obviously contacted you and had to do it for my mobile phone because my laptop broke. But it's been really lovely. It's been really great. The different people that are on my little group is wonderful. A real cross section and people that I maybe not really would talk to normally and have really sort of got to know. I think the thing I really enjoyed is that everyone's always questioning and everyone has, you know, wonders about parts of, you know, faith and things like that. And the little videos that you watch kind of make it feel very normal that you can question things and think about things deeply and chat about it and talk about it. Yeah. And there's no sort of perfect answer, if you like. So I think for me, those two were the biggest things that I really enjoyed.
Yeah. That's brilliant. And thank you for that. And I think there may be people watching this now, or there may be people who've been invited to Alpha or just probably didn't go on the last one for whatever reason. And I'd just like to ask you the question, Kaz, is why would you recommend to them to go on the course?
It's just a really good chance to talk to people about life and to find out more about, like, you know, obviously Jesus and God and the Bible, and it just made me a lot more comfortable with the whole aspect of faith and what that meant to me. And it was really good because when we talked about it, you kind of put it in a modern world, if you like, and because everyone's talking about it together, everybody puts their own sort of view on it and makes it much more relatable. So things that I might before have thought, well, it's not for me because of this and this and this, just talking to a couple of people in the group, suddenly it makes more sense and I can interpret it so it relates to me myself. So I would say, definitely, if there's a little tinge of wonder about it, you know, I wonder if I should do that, I would say do it.
Brilliant. Kaz, that's wonderful. Thank you so much for spending the time just to share that with us. And we'll see you soon.
Bye. Yes, see you soon. Thanks. Bye.
Bye-bye.
So thanks, Nigel and Kaz. Do please be praying for Alpha, for those who have done it. Many of us maybe be praying, being thankful for how it's also touched our lives. And now in the run-up to Christmas is a really great time to be thinking about maybe whether it might be right for us to do Alpha, or maybe if there's someone, a friend or family member, that we could invite to come along and over those few weeks just to explore what life's about in a friendly and safe way. In terms of our church family news, once again, the email's gone out on Friday. Just like to probably draw three things to your attention. Firstly, do please be praying for carols come to you, happening all over town this week. So hopefully you might be out and about and hearing some of those carol services on people's doorsteps that we're going to be doing. Do pray for that initiative. Also pray for our online carol service shared across the mission community that's going to be going live on YouTube next weekend. Why don't you watch it? Maybe suggest to a friend or neighbour to watch it as well. And obviously at this time of year there's a huge amount that's taking place, but we also don't want to lose sight of a New Year's just round the corner. This last year has been different to what any of us could have imagined. And it's been very different in our church life. We want to look back as well as looking forward. And we're very conscious that it's been really hard since it's been so hard for us to meet together. In January, we want to do something which we're going to call the Big Church Conversation. And at the heart of it is simply every single household in our church receiving a phone call from someone else in the church family, where there's an opportunity just to talk and share news, maybe things that we're looking forward to, maybe there were things that we're fearful about, might be how we've been hearing God speak to us. In order to do that, we probably need about 20 or 30 people who are willing during the month of January to make phone calls to specific people in church that we will ask. We want everyone to be part of this. So even those that are making the phone calls will also be on the list to receive some phone calls themselves. We hope it will be a really affirming thing, encouraging of what it means to be the body of Christ. So I'd therefore like to invite you maybe to consider if you could just give up a little bit of time in January to make some of those calls. If you're willing to do that, please respond to the bit in the news sheet by emailing Beth in the office and we'll get back to you with further details. Wouldn't it be amazing to start the new year thinking about how in a tangible way we're part of the body of Christ together here in Sidmouth? We're going to conclude our service now though by once again singing a great Advent hymn that reminds us of what we're looking forward to. O come, Emmanuel, as we look forward to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who saves us and gives us and the whole world hope. And so as we look forward to the coming of Emmanuel, God with us, as we look forward to a week where we're going to have that opportunity maybe on the doorstep to be singing carols, to maybe be celebrating through our online carol service next weekend. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you that you are with us through the power of your Holy Spirit and that you speak to us today. Help us to hear your voice, to look forward to your coming, and be willing to play our part in the building of your kingdom. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us this day and always. Amen.